those just tuning in, it is May 8, 2021. Sun-Uranus. So remember Uranus, rebirth, BPM 4. These are very emancipatory transits and aspects. I think Rick Tarnas was born with Sun trine Uranus very close on his ascendant and midheaven. Sun, midheaven, trine Uranus, ascendant. Liberation of light, warmth, vitality, Sun in BPM 4. I don't know enough about evolutionary astrology to really talk about the similarities and differences, and that's maybe a project down the road, but I do not agree with what I've heard, the assessment that Uranus is connected with trauma. I just don't see that as sort of fitting into my experience. I think Saturn is connected with trauma, Pluto with trauma. Uranus is what's trying to liberate us from it. And as I've said before, it may be seen that way because under these transits, we just can't hold things in anymore. They break out. But if we're actively putting ourselves in situations where we are allowing the uncovering process to happen, then these transits are fantastic. I love Uranus transits, and I want, you know, as many as I can get, basically, any Uranus transit. And same with Neptune. So, and sadly, I'm getting hardcore Pluto as well. Saturn, I don't quite love quite as much, but it always is good for me. So a heightened sense of freedom and autonomy. Both the Sun and Uranus are connected with autonomy, selfhood, individuation and independence, unique opportunities for creative self-expression, unexpected breakthroughs and awakenings, and the brilliant light of rebirth. Light is an important part of BPM 4, and the Sun sort of inflects it toward light in particular. Now, the shadow side, manic self-celebration, willful and erratic behavior, excessive urges for independence, and an inability to cooperate or compromise with others. Alex Stein did a great presentation on ANN this week, and with the Saturn square Uranus in the sky, a lot of people are talking about their loss of freedom. Somebody's trying to take away our freedom. And I mean, this does happen, no question about it, but many people also overreact and feel that way even when it's not really happening. We can never get rid of Saturn. Saturn is always going to be in the picture. There is no total freedom, you know, on this level, on the level of living in the samsara. There's no freedom without Saturn, rather, would be another way to say it. We have to be responsible. The quote from Dylan that I mentioned under Saturn Uranus, to live above the law, you must be honest. And there's one way to look at that. So these transits seem to coincide with periods when we're feeling a sudden resolution of problems in our lives or the culmination of a creative project. I just came through this several years ago as I published The Archetypal Universe. It sort of came on the idea to write it from my notes that I had from like 20 years previous up to that point. And I wrote it and published it, and you know, it was all quite exciting. New inspiration and creative enthusiasm. It liberates our natural autonomy and self-expression. We can have an increase in confidence. Great times to transcend old patterns, to discover new talents. Sudden resolution of difficult situations. I remember feeling under some Uranus to Sun transits that the universe is giving me a longer leash and a more of an opportunity to show what I could do. You know, the Sun seems to shine a little more brightly. So the Sun activates in a kind of a general way, whatever it touches. So the Uranian Promethean urge toward freedom, to take risks, change vocations. These are good transits to pursue a hobby or to try to turn a hobby into a vocation. You know, something like astrology, for example, maybe to begin making money from it in some way. So the shadow side, sort of the Sun's egocentrism, selfhood, And Uranus urge for individualism and non-conformism can make it difficult for people to cooperate or compromise. So rebelling just for the sake of rebelling, whether there are any real or serious issues at stake. Rob Hand talks a lot about that in Planets in Transit. And aversion to any kind of structure or routine can also make life in the real world difficult. Living in co-op houses, I could say that it's the moderate majority that makes a co-op house run, you know, basically. And then there's always going to be some irresponsible people on one end that won't do their share of the work or clean up after themselves. Usually they're younger. And then there's going to be a few overly Saturnian people on the other end that are too uptight, too rigid. They want to punish the other ones. And then the moderate majority tries to prevent the punishing ones from overdoing it with the irresponsible ones. That's society. Manic hyperactivity or nervous tensions are possible, reflecting the influence of perinatal material pressing upward from within. It's trying to break free and we can't hold it in anymore. And it's a better problem to have if we have options for processing. So a brilliant, bright, and sunny atmosphere in dreams, unexpected sunshine, images of coming out the end of a long corridor, successfully tricking an oppressor, feelings of heroic jubilation. Heroism is connected both with the sun and with Uranus. Warm and loving fathers. With the remember, BPM-4 is like this influx of love. So Uranus is connected with that brotherly, sisterly feelings. And then the sun would inflect it toward masculine dream figures, like fathers. Remember, this is the father within us. It's our inner father, our inner son. Four men sitting around a table with sunshine streaming in. A classic dream. This was one of mine. Four connected with Uranus and BPM-4. And then sunshine streaming in. Now, these are very positive influences in sessions. Uranus to sun transits are 3 years, so that wouldn't really be a factor in timing sessions, though you might want to do more during those transits. But to have transiting sun hitting the natal Uranus would be a highly desirable transit, like so many other transits. And I would, you know, like the square, the opposition, I would way rather have those than not have them in sessions. We can gain access to coex memory systems around personal successes and breakthroughs in our lives. And these transits support the healing of issues with our father, with males in general, with our own solar heart. Like when you think of, we often think of heart as being connected with Venus, and it is connected with Venus, like love. But the sun is, the heart is also like courage, the hearty person, or that side of us that can open into the world with confidence. The BPM-4 Stan found is connected with a full opening of the heart chakra, and a lot of it, the death rebirth struggle of BPM-3 is about opening the heart chakra. And so for some people it would be to open it, and for many others it would be open more than it already is. It probably maybe already is open quite a bit, but the end result is everyone's heart chakra opens fully in that ego death experience. Any questions so far? Okay, rebirth of light. Out of the shadows of night, the world rolls into light. It is daybreak everywhere. Longfellow, sun trine Uranus. Love those lines. The grave itself is but a covered bridge leading from light to light through a brief darkness. Life is filled with light. Death can be difficult. And then after we successfully die, our consciousness is reunited with the divine, or reawakened to our divine nature. We're back in the light. A famous quote that of Kepler, Sun, Mercury, Uranus, that Rick loves, and I got this from him. Now, since the dawn 8 months ago, since the broad daylight 3 months ago, and since a few days ago when the full sun illuminated my wonderful speculations, nothing holds me back. Remember, Kepler is the one who took Copernicus's ideas of the heliocentric solar system. So the sun at the center of the solar system, not the earth as our medieval and classical forebears believed, but the modern fact that the sun is at the center, heliocentric. Kepler was a mathematician, and he was able to show that with elliptical orbits, all the observed retrogrades of the planets make total sense. Up to the discovery of elliptical orbits, they couldn't quite reconcile it with the observed retrogrades. That was a huge problem, was the planets going forward and backwards. But with the ellipses, it all made sense. So I yield freely to the sacred frenzy. I dare frankly to confess that I have stolen the golden vessels of the Egyptians to build a tabernacle for my God far from the bounds of Egypt. If you pardon me, I shall rejoice. If you reproach me, I shall endure. Remember those lines. That's a good one to throw out in a casual conversation. The die is cast, and I am writing the book to be read either now or by posterity. It matters not. It can wait a century for a reader, as God himself has waited 6,000 years for a witness. Amazing Promethean ecstasy there that he's describing. Remember, this Promethean ecstasy is the third form of ecstasy identified by Stan and Rick. Connected with Uranus, Promethean ecstasy. Volcanic ecstasy is connected with Pluto, fusion of all opposites in this driving amalgam of energies and emotions. It doesn't reach peace, though, until you make the transition to BPM 4, until that transition happens. You're always going somewhere. It's not a resolved state. And then there's the Neptunian ecstasy, which Stan calls melted or oceanic or Apollonian, as in Apollo. So great quote. And there's an attempt to depict Promethean ecstasy of Rick. An artist drew that for me. And Rick said he was flattered that we, you know, used him, but his experience of it was more that it was in the crown chakra rather than the sixth chakra there. So the liberating masculine, the good father archetype. On the one hand, the masculine principle, again in both men and women, can be understood in terms of what may be called the Promethean impulse, restless, heroic, rebellious, and revolutionary, individualistic and innovative, eternally seeking freedom, autonomy, change, and the new. And you can see, you know, his understanding or articulation of the masculine principle certainly influenced by the trine from Uranus to his son. There's an oppressive side of the masculine principle too, you know, the judging father archetype. His writing has been described as having a fascinating lucidity. So one of his friends, Keith Thompson, wrote that about the passion of the Western mind. And that's certainly my experience, Sun Uranus. Yeah, archetype of the hero. A heartfelt prostrate admiration, submission, burning, boundless for a noblest godlike form of man. Thomas Carlyle, his great man theory of history. Now, ideas like this are definitely suspect and arousing of suspicion in the postmodern era for a good reason. This is the kind of inflated, cheesy hopes that led to all kinds of cruel behavior by the patriarchal Europeans. But this was a stage in history, kind of connected with the Enlightenment, I think. I'm not sure exactly when Carlyle was, I forget, but his theory was that he called the great man theory, that history was essentially created by these great figures that would have all these ideas, and that they were essentially the main sort of drivers of human progress. Now, Edith Wharton, the ages are but baubles hung upon the thread of some strong lives, and one slight wrist may lift a century above the dust. So very similar idea. And I mean, in our own time, we could see people like Mother Teresa, Gandhi, Martin Luther, King, and others. Rousseau, I have entered on an enterprise which is without precedent and will have no imitator. I propose to show my fellows a man as nature made him, and this man shall be myself. That's very confident, but try saying that in a modern situation. You'd be laughed out of the coffee shop. You know, it's like, get out of here, man. Imagine people talking like that back then. Now, Freud, where id was, there shall ego be. So this was Freud's heroic view of the psyche, that space cannot kind of coexist. So if there's id somewhere, there can't be ego. And his idea was by free association and remembering the past, gradually expand the ego to move into the territories where previously there was the swamp or the cesspool of the id. So that's kind of the Sun-Uranus rising above Pluto. That's how we could see it. Actually, he has Sun-Uranus square Pluto. Sun-Uranus square Pluto. My dad has that as well. Sun-Uranus square Pluto. And today we are experiencing something that looks very much like the death of modern man. Indeed, that looks very much like the death of Western man. Perhaps the end of man himself is at hand. But man is not a goal. Man is something that must be overcome and fulfilled in the embrace of the feminine. I think these are his very last words of The Passion of the Western Mind, which is, if you haven't read it, he talks about the importance of astrology in and astronomy in Western history, but it's not an astrological book. It's a book about Western ideas and the evolution of ideas. But so this is very much kind of Nietzschean, the sense that we're overcoming ourselves and into some higher form of ourselves. And man, Rick suggests, was the protagonist of the sort of high culture, at least, of Western civilization for, you know, since perhaps the time of the Greeks, but that has changed now. There's an ego death that is happening and has happened, and that is not the situation anymore. Now, bright enthusiasm. My candle burns at both ends. It will not last the night, but ah, my foes and oh, my friends, it gives a lovely light. Love that. Life is either a daring adventure or nothing. To keep our faces toward change and behave like free spirits in the presence of fate is strength undefeatable. Helen Keller. Either a daring adventure or nothing. Not too many people over 30 or 40 have that attitude anymore. I believe in a lively disrespect for most forms of authority. Sun opposition Uranus, classic. So question authority. This is the kind of the essence of postmodernism, and it's not a bad thing to have. But on the other hand, sometimes those in authority are good. Sometimes there are good laws. There's good leadership at times. So we have to discriminate and discern. Let the world know you as you are, not as you think you should be. Because sooner or later, if you are posing, you will forget the pose. And then where are you? Fanny Bryce, Sun conjunct Uranus. So being authentic, expressing one's true self. Whoso would be a man must be a nonconformist. From the great transcendentalist philosopher, mid-19th century, Emerson. Sun trine Uranus, love that. Whoso would be a man must be a nonconformist. And we could substitute whoso would be a person, an individual. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. Robert Frost. I love these pictures that show people at the sort of three stages of their lives. I think I will actually read the whole poem. I forgot that I had it here. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both, and be one traveler long I stood, and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear, though as for that the passing there had worn them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. Beautiful poem about taking the road less trodden. And that's a wonderful poem. It was put to music, and we sang that in our community choir that I was in grade 11 and 12. My dad was the conductor. It was very sweet. I often mention this poem to my clients that have Sun-Uranus aspects. Let's see here. Okay, the arts. Meryl Streep, Sun conjunct Uranus, almost exact. So the sense of being her own woman, independent, a bright leader, has spoken out on issues such as the disparity between salaries of male and female actors, great variety of roles, one of the few non-character actors, proficient technical skills as well. Remember, she criticized Trump when he was making fun of the reporter who was disabled. Trump kind of acted like he was mentally challenged, Trump himself. I think that came somewhat naturally to him, but she criticized that at the Oscars last year, I believe. So it's 1 minute from exact. That's 1/60th of a degree, her Sun conjunct Uranus. So Kramer versus Kramer. Anybody remember this one? This is a real classic in its day. I'll show you this.
I have a whole speech.
No, go ahead.
I don't know. All my life, I've felt like somebody's wife or somebody's mother or somebody's daughter. Even all the time we were together, I never knew who I was. And that's why I had to go away. And in California, I think I found myself. And I got myself a job. I got myself a therapist, a really good one. And I feel better about myself than I ever have in my whole life. And I've learned a great deal about myself.
Such as?
Yeah, so then it kind of gets more dicey because she wants to regain shared custody with their son. And he's had sole custody of the son. And then there's this huge legal battle. But this is a classic feminist or female empowerment moment in films in the early 70s. And it's amazing. My mom kind of looks a little like her. And, she went to California to find herself 1973. So that's quite interesting for me. And this is the first role I ever saw her in, I think. Now, in 1977, Betty Davis was the first woman to receive the American Film Institute Life Achievement Award. She was also highly publicized in battles against studio control. She was a rebel, and I think she has Sun Square Uranus. I need to write that in there. And then Ida Lupino, and so I don't have her in there either, also Sun Uranus. She was not the first. female director in Hollywood. There were scores in the silent era, but as Hollywood's only female director in the 1940s and 1950s, she opened the way for future female screenwriters and directors, wrote and produced her own films. She was a real pioneer. Okay, another side of Sun-Uranus emerges when the eccentric tendencies of these archetypes lead to obstinacy or uncooperativeness. A do-it my way rebellious independence that works against genuine freedom. The classic example is Orson Welles. And then here's a quote: without the strictness of Hollywood, the success of Citizen Kane, and then A Touch of Evil, he gained tremendous freedom, creative freedom, but it wasn't such a good recipe for him. He became gigantically disorganized, quirky, and confused, living in an agony of indecision, muddle, and frustration as he dashed from one exotic location to another. Impatience with detail, manic dissatisfaction. He'd be working on several movies at once in two different places, flying back and forth. And I remember an interview quote where he said, "I'm frustrated, don't you see?" He says, "You know, I have a drawer full of screenplays," and he just wasn't able to kind of focus in. There's a kind of a manic quality that, and he's a Sun square Uranus, I believe. And then in this masterpiece, Citizen Kane, Kane personifies this self-will and obstinacy with the fateful decision to remain with his lover, Susan, at the expense of his career. He bellows out to his wife, his political opponent, Geddes, and the world, "There is only one person in this world who decides what I'm going to do, and that's me." So you could see that in an admirable way or in a tragic way. Remember, the Greeks were very afraid of hubris, and Sun Uranus or Jupiter Uranus very much connected with that kind of hubris, or Jupiter in general as well. And they felt like if your ego is too high, that's where the gods will aim their lightning. They were very much concerned about this problem. And here he is kind of going for it in this role. This character. So Sun Mercury square Uranus moon, spectacular creative originality, but also became manic, disorganized, obstinate, and uncooperative. He's the one who created the War of the Worlds scare. He was reading H.G. Wells, I believe, teleplay on the radio, War of the Worlds, and it was so convincing that thousands of Americans started freaking out, and there were traffic jams to leave cities and stuff. And for a while, it was a big, big panic. Now, the precocious brightness and manic optimism of Vivian Leigh's characters, Sun square Uranus moon. So same as Wells, Sun square Uranus moon. "Nothing's turned out as I wanted it, and I'll think of some way to get him back." As you see the optimism, "after all, tomorrow is another day." That's from the very end of Gone with the Wind. Now, Francis Sequoyan, who was the driving creative force behind, you know, the Astrologer's Handbook, one of the big influences on Rick Tarnas, and then he recommended it, or I had discovered it actually before I went to Esalen. She says, "Irrational behavior due to nervous tension at critical times can cause the natives to destroy what has taken them a long time to create." Irrational behavior. Now, is this? Oh, no, this is Lauren Bacall and Robert Mitchum. So a milder form of this can be seen in Robert Mitchum's notorious "I don't care" attitude for many years, Hollywood's bad boy. A similar quality can be seen in Lauren Bacall, who in her career refused to do many roles and was suspended by her studio bosses 12 times. And you know, we talked about Betty Davis. I've forgotten to add in the aspects here, but there's a list on another slide. So they both have major Sun Uranus. Now, Roseanne Barr, Sun Trine Uranus. "On my show, I'm the boss and father knows squat." Roseanne in the episode where she meets the mothers from past sitcoms. That's pretty funny. And then Elizabeth Montgomery, Sun, Venus, Uranus, triple conjunction in Aries. Star of Bewitched, which began in 1967. Mischievous, emancipated character. I loved her when I was a kid. I used to come home from school and watch Bewitched. I really liked this character a lot. Sun, Venus, Uranus, and Aries is just so fiery and bright and upfront. And sort of, she's her own woman. Now, the free spirit of Gina Davis, Sun opposition Uranus. She plays kind of kooky characters at times as well, zany. Now, L. Frank Baum, Sun conjunct Uranus, author of The Wonderful Wizard of Oz, with its vivid, endearing symbol of the spiritual path, the yellow brick road. Golden light often appears in the inner field of individuals as they experience rebirth and release from the confining birth canal, an event associated with transits of Uranus. And I mentioned it before, but Aldous Huxley wrote an essay called Why Are Precious Metals Precious? His theory is that it's because we see those colors in rebirth experiences, which is our deepest yearning, is to have those experiences. And so gold is a kind of a material substitute for something that we are really craving internally. I actually had a dream of gold last night, but I immediately when I woke up, I was like, I knew that it was like Uranus. I'm just starting in on Uranus square Uranus. I'm really looking forward to it. Yeah, so there they are. Shirley MacLaine, Sun square Uranus, quite eccentric, but also progressive. She was one of the main leaders, you could say, of the New Age movement of the 80s. Now, one of the enduring qualities of Sun-Uranus aspects is the capacity to let go, to be crazy in a fun and liberated way. We can see this in actors known for their goofy, wacky, manic, and crazy antics, such as Jerry Lewis, Sun-Uranus, conjunction sextile Mars. He's I don't think too many people watch him now, probably here in the West, but he's considered a genius without parallel in France. For many decades, he was really popular in France. So now Carol Burnett, Sun, Mercury, Uranus, you can see similar wacky, zany, versatile, great comedian. Steve Carell, or Carell, Sun conjunct Uranus, quirky, spontaneous. He could really play those characters. I like your hair. It looks like wet popcorn. He's speaking to this female nerd character in Anchorman 2. If you haven't seen that, both of those are really funny with Will Ferrell. Now, Oscar Hammerstein from Oklahoma. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. He was the lyricist. His irrepressible brightness. Okay, beautiful.
And the first thing that I heard was a song outside my window, and the traffic wrote the words. It came a ringing up like Christmas bells and wrapping up like
fire. You can really hear that warmth. Jupiter at the Sun Uranus midpoint. These are not minor aspects when it's within 2 degrees. I have Sun at the Jupiter Uranus midpoint, quite similar. Rick told me that I had that one special day at dinner time in the Esalen Lodge, and the sun was just hitting the water, and I'd been reading all about Sun Uranus in his Prometheus the Awakener unpublished manuscript, and then he told me I had that. I was a free man in Paris. I felt unfettered and alive. It's amazing that she chose free man. Of course, that's a famous line, right? But she sort of, that solar archetype coming through. And then Bob Dylan, Sun conjunct Uranus in a big stellium with the Moon and Jupiter and Saturn there too. So happy just to be alive underneath the sky of blue on this new morning with you. That is a very exciting, arousing, sort of inspiring song. And then, I don't know if you know this song, check it out on YouTube. It's a very short, powerful song, Father of Night. Father of night, father of day, father who taketh the darkness away, father who teacheth the birds to fly, builder of rainbows up in the sky, and father of loneliness and pain, father of sun and father of rain, devotional tribute to the good father archetype. This was a beautiful moment in his writing. Now, Jimi Hendrix, high-flying genius who revolutionized rock guitar, electrified culture hero, high-flying Icarus of the counterculture. Excuse me while I kiss the sky. I think he has Sun square Uranus. I can't remember. I got to go back and write these in. Now here's Shania Twain. We ended up watching her concert videos at work a lot, and I developed a lot of respect for her as a songwriter and performer. And this anthem, Man, I Feel Like a Woman, anthem of autonomy and celebration, Sun, Uranus, Pluto. She's got that 60s energy just centered right on her sun. This was one of the most popular songs of the 90s and very paradigmatic. I was at a pub like Sweetwater's, I believe it was. I don't know if they're still there in the 90s. A club, and this song came on and every woman in the place jumped instantly onto the dance floor. I mean, this, and it was a very impressive moment. So here we go. Oh, 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 get in the action. Feel the attraction. Cover my head, do what I dare. Oh, 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 I wanna be free, yeah. Feel the way I feel. Man, I feel like a woman. Doesn't really do it justice. That's the 10% that I'm allowed to show. So her moon Venus, which we'll talk about later, really shines through too in some of those devotional love songs. She did a duet with Elton John that is incredibly sweet. Now George Harrison, Sun square Uranus Saturn, the exuberant spiritual songs of his solo career. I see that typo there. Harrison and the Beatles always had the aura of being different somehow. This is reflected in both his Sun Uranus and Sun Saturn squares, though in different ways. The Saturn square expressed a shyness, his sort of undemonstrative, undramatic personality compared with the other three Beatles. They were very kind of extroverted. We can see the Uranus square in the uniquely recognizable, untypical flavor of his songs. His introduction of the sitar to Western music in the song Norwegian Wood, one of those songs from 1966. He learned sitar from Ravi Shankar. His continued commitment to meditation and spirituality, appearing somehow beyond the lawsuits and nasty songs which Lennon and McCartney wrote about each other. So aura of independence. And then it's Here Comes the Sun, one of his great songs. That was my high school graduation song in June 1977. And it was playing over the little loudspeaker for the intercom, and it started to skip. The song started to skip. Someone had to go and move the needle, but it was still pretty special. Now the buoyant and uplifting spiritual vision of Bob Marley, with Sun Trine Uranus redemption song, Everything's Gonna Be All Right. I really feel that Sun Uranus, his music. Now Peter Gabriel, Sun Trine Uranus. Sinead O'Connor, Feels So Different. And certainly an eccentric genius, both the positive and the more troubling sides of this combination, I think we can see in her life. Now, in art, Monet, Sun Trine Uranus, his one of the central figures of Impressionism. Now, this painting Impression Sunrise reveals the moment of transition to daytime, celebration of the moment, spontaneous life, light, and motion. These are the hallmarks of Impressionism: light, spontaneity, and then bright innovations. And he's here choosing the sun as a subject. By the way, this sun rising, this is sun in the 12th house. This is the moment of maximum excitement when the sun comes over the horizon and that sudden beaming enthusiasm of the you know, reborn sun. It seems to have little to do in the natural experience of it with the meaning of the sun in the 12th house. And I believe that the 12th house is one of those traditional meanings which needs serious revision. Rob Hand suggests that as well. The Greeks loved symmetry. And I think when they got to the 12th house, they just thought, well, we've got a bunch of negative stuff we haven't covered yet, so let's just shovel it into the 12th house. I mean, if the houses and the signs are somewhat congruent, Pisces is not a negative sign. Pisces is not associated with insanity and imprisonment and lack of confidence and all that. It's just, I mean, Rick Tarnas is a Pisces. I don't subscribe to that. And then the Gokulan research also found that the hit zone for Mars on the ascendant in a higher than random frequency in the charts of Olympic athletes and famous professional athletes, that hit zone included part of the 12th house. And that was a very strong placement of Mars that showed up in the charts of athletes. So that those are the two arguments about the 12th house. I may have mentioned that before. Now, Monet's Poppy Field in Argenteuil, is that right? I know I got some French experts here, Tatiana and Eve. Let's take a stab at it. Now, Manet, Edouard Manet, Uranus at the Sun, Jupiter, very similar to Joni Mitchell, also one of the main figures of Impressionism. And then the third major figure in Impressionism, I think, is usually considered a Degas, Sun Quincunx Uranus. Yeah. He was also, one of his favorite subjects was dance, and he has a major Venus-Mars trend aspect, which we'll look at. Any thoughts on Sun Uranus?
I just wanted to share that my daughter has a Jupiter-Uranus conjunction trining her sun, which is in the midheaven.
Wow. That's wonderful.
Yeah, she's so pretty bright and courageous.
Is she born in like 83?
Yeah.
Yeah, great. Yeah. Any other thoughts? Anyone here? Oh, go ahead.
I thought that musical singing sessions were really interesting. I used to work for the Jimi Hendrix Family Foundation as a graphic designer. So that totally made sense to me that he was a Sun Uranus. And I just read a biography of George Harrison, Working Class Mystic, and that totally makes sense. So thank you.
That kind of fits that working class Saturn, mystic Uranus. Mm-hmm. He also came out of the gate when the Beatles split up, you know, galloping. I mean, he had the first great post Beatles album, the Concert of Bangladesh, which was an amazing, the first Live Aid concert, or the not Live Aid per se, but benefit concert for Bangladesh, and you know, a real pioneer. Yeah, thanks for sharing that, Kelly. Yeah, any other thoughts?